Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, in case you're joining us for the first time, this show airs every Thursdays at 10 p.m. and the repeat is on Saturdays at 8 a.m. So make a date and see what you can pick up. Also, for more info about business content, you can check our websites, the New Vision website. Plus, on the morning show, Rush Hour, yes, we have a segment there for business where we share different business tips just for you to improve your operations. Let's talk how to make money. And in this two-part series, a very interesting conversation. We're talking turning passion into money. And that is the story of Sarah Seranja, who, after her failed desire and dream to work in Bank of Uganda, she chose to settle down and start her own business. Now she is making money and she's counting over 10 years in this business. Now the interesting bit for her is that she has decided to employ some of her family members through the journey, okay, because this, according to her story, as you're going to watch, helps a bit in the event that there's slow business. Family members won't put you under pressure to pay them. It's something that you might want to think about. Let's first run you through this and then we'll see you shortly how to make money.
I'm Sarah Seruwaji. I'm the director and founder of Oxknit Designers. And having worked, I worked for 16 years in the biotech lab at Makerere, but I wanted to do something different. So I did a degree in business management with hopes of joining Bank of Uganda, which didn't happen. So I tried out option B, that was knitting. By then I had only 10,000 shillings on my account. I went and bought this book from Aristoc. And I taught myself how to hand knit a baby sweater. This is like a 3 months old, but it took me a whole month to complete it. So I was perturbed. I asked myself, how do these people who make sweaters in bulk to supply schools, how do they do it? So I learned that there are machines. So I went to Chiembe, bought this domestic knitting machine. And in 3 weeks, I'd learned how to operate it. So I went back home and trained my mom and my siblings. My mom, by the way, she's 76.
Okay.
I trained her how to knit and my siblings, and they quickly picked up the idea. Then in no time, we had got a school order of 50 sweaters. So after supplying those sweaters, I realized that this hobby can be turned into a business. So that's when we began the Vocational Training Institute. We are like, according to statistics, there are so many women, around 16 million women and young girls, who are facing unemployment and poverty. And because of this poverty, they can't afford the normal education, like in vocational training schools. So we were like, if we start up this will help women, since it's in 3 months, somebody has learned a skill and they can better their livelihoods. So that's how we started. We started with these small machines. Each machine went on buying another since we got more clientele.
Okay.
So we went on expanding. We didn't begin with all this.
All right.
We had only one.
Okay. So let's first, backtrack a bit, because we've gone so far away from a failed Bank of Uganda employee to buying these machines. So where does your dream die of working in Bank of Uganda? At what point did you think, okay, this won't work, let me go?
After applying like for a year, because I kept applying. To one extent I was like, if I apply like a cleaner, maybe, because my mom was working in Bank of Uganda, so I had an idea. She was being driven home, we had privileges of being dropped and taken to school. Life was okay. Now here she has retired and things are not.
So you wanted it to be a family thing?
Yeah, I wanted to also go in Bank of Uganda, which didn't happen. So I tried out my option B.
Okay. So your option B looks to have worked many years later. But from the start, what are some of the things you did to make this thing? Of course, you faced challenges of learning how to make something as small as that for a very long time.
Yes.
But what are some of the things you did from the start that made you slowly build up?
I had passion, because going to learn this, I wasn't thinking of making money. Mm. I was just doing it as a hobby because I was still employed at Makere. Okay. So I was just doing it as a hobby, just to kill time, just to make things. But with time, I saw people interested in my items. That's when I was like, by the way, instead of just doing it as a hobby and you make things and wear them yourself, you can increase on your revenue by training more people.
So let's now move forward. So you have now bought the machines, and where does the journey go from there? You get your first gig for schools.
Yes.
I can imagine how excited you were.
I was excited. Uh-huh. I literally, when, after the school was in Chikoni.
Okay.
The moment the Basa paid me money, I literally ran. I was like, I hope they don't call me back to withdraw this money from me. I literally ran out of the school and went back. I just went up to Makere because I was there.
Yeah.
And I was like, I think this is mind-blowing. How do you make sweaters in just 2 weeks and you get paid just...
So we're talking 2010-ish?
Yes.
And I don't know how much that was, but it should have been a lot of money, given
to me,
the time.
Yeah, it was. It was. Mm. I don't remember also the exact money, but it was, being that it was adding on, topping up my salary.
So buying the book sounds like one of the brilliant ideas you chose, but what else did you do after buying the book?
I went and after learning, I had to learn more because the people who taught me just taught me basics. But I kept going on researching on Google, on YouTube, and I kept trying to do more designs because YouTube has a variety of things you can do. Mm. So I had to keep learning more things. If I do this, what happens? If I do this? And what motivated me more is people kept buying my things, the people I was working with. So I would go to work, but still to work.
Your marketing manager, yes. Your business as well. You talk about passion. That was like one of the key things that stood out. What was the other thing that, all the other things that helped you stay focused on this?
My family, once they also picked up, and they weren't only helping me out, but they were also, I was paying them now. Mm. Because...
Were you employing some of them?
Yes.
Oh, that's nice.
My siblings, my mom, I was paying my mom, I was paying my nieces, my nephew.
So on top of her pension, you're still paying again. Wow.
Yes. Now it became an income. Mm. So even when I would go to work, they would remain working. In the sitting room, they would push the sofa set to that side and work.
So at what point did you then leave Makere finally?
After COVID, in fact, I didn't leave willingly. We were told there is less money. I was working on a project. Mm. So I was one of the people who were laid off because the project wasn't getting more money to pay us. But it came as, I was like, wow, it was like a relief because somehow I couldn't chase myself.
Yeah.
Yet I wasn't adding even more to them because I wasn't willing even to upgrade.
To fit somewhere.
Yeah, to fit somewhere. Mm. So it was like, wow, Sarah, you can, this as in Luganda, they say, Basindi sa sitamye. So,
cool.
Yeah, so I was,
yeah.
It was, I was like, I think now I can do my things.
Mm.
So.
So now that you finally, you know, means you had more time for your business. Now,
yes.
Talk to us about how important it is for someone that is running a business to have all their focus on something they love.
First and foremost, somebody should have passion before they think of getting money out of the business. They should have passion because passion gives you mileage. Once the passion runs out, you will leave everything. You will leave the business. But once you have passion, the passion will push you even when there is no money coming in yet. So you have to have passion, and I advise people not to leave a job to start a job. Start a job so that you leave your job. And the good thing is, when you do these hands-on skills, you can employ your family members, neighbors, village mates. Unlike the skill, like the business management I did, I did science, technology, biology, I can't pass it on to my kid. I can't say my kid, oh, you go and work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just like your mom failed to pass it to the bank.
Yeah.
All right. So it looks like all of a sudden this thing is working, and then you have family members, you know, starting with family members. why didn't you choose to look for a job? Because look, you're a graduate, you'd have still tried something off Bank of Uganda, you'd have still tried something else. Did you think it was now enough? You were done with working for people?
I had a rough idea of what other banks give, and I wasn't in position to leave Makerere and go in those banks. My mind was strictly Bank of Uganda. If it's not Bank of Uganda, I'm not going to any other bank.
Where are we now?
Now, we expanded. Our first branch is in Ntinda at my parents' home.
Okay.
After my father seeing that the business is bringing in money, he gave me portion of the, aside, besides the house, we put up a small structure. Halfway this room, we put up a small structure and we were operating from there. Students were coming in, we are training them from there. Then afterwards he was like, your business is overgrowing. Let me give you land in Butambala. That's where his land is. He gave me an acre to put up a vocational training institute. So the machines were too many and the vocational is a long-term process to build.
Yeah, that's right.
So I was like, this structure was half done the way you see it. So my husband is like, bring some of the work here. In Luganda, they say basesa gwaka. So if you've not lit yourself, it's hard for somebody to rekindle you, to keep your fire burning. So my husband was like, take this whole house, instead of us putting in tenants, put in your machines. So I carried some of the machines to this Masoli branch.
So when you listen to Sarah's story, the first thing you could say is, well, maybe she's one of the lucky people that came from families where they didn't need money to start a business. But look, the question is, how many people come from families that have money but can't start a single business? There are always going to be basics that you need to get right for you to start your business. And for her, it was passion and self-drive. What is yours? If you were given cash, can you start up something, or you could spend it overnight and, you know, get back and still say it is hard to run a business in Uganda? Every time you say it is hard to run a business in Uganda, there are some people that are probably also thriving in the same economy. So maybe there are things that you need to do, some checks and balances that you need to employ in your business to see just what else you can do to improve moving forward. This week and the whole of this month, we said we're celebrating women in business, and don't miss next week's part two of the same conversation with Sarah, and she'll be telling us the future for her business, because there is even a vocational institute that she's starting up to empower women and young girls that are trying to make a living. Interesting stuff. And those are the women that we should be celebrating, women creating impact in society. Okay, let's talk personal finance tips for this week. So we've made the money, so how do we keep it? Here are the tips.
Charles, please introduce yourself. Welcome to this segment.
Thanks, Cynthia. Charles Katongole, Head of Financial Markets with Standard Chartered Bank.
Fantastic. So, Charles, we are here today because you are an expert, you are a thought leader, you've been doing this for years, and we are talking investment, okay? Now, we want to tackle the particular issue of insurance, and I know that less than 1% of people are insured, but it's an investment vehicle, isn't it?
Yeah, it's both investment and risk.
Okay, tell me more about that.
Well, from our personal perspective, I guess the most basic insurance that we use is health insurance. And I have to admit, that's paid by the employer, but it's one of the key benefits that we get. I have sat with friends, and just a mere, okay, it seems mere until you have to pay. But when you get into a hospital with a sick child, and they bring that bill, then you start wondering how you'd manage that. Now, the health insurance that's paid for by the insurer, you can actually also pay for it individually. It comes in to save quite a bit. And I think that's something we can all, at least for the parents, can attest to. When you get into that hospital and the child is coughing like mad, and they bring you a 300,000 bill, and you're thinking,
Charles, the
okay.
example you're using of a child coughing is even better. Imagine going to have a baby,
exactly.
and you have to go for surgery,
exactly,
and the bill is like 30 million exactly. unplanned for. Yet you could, isn't it possible to save like little 50,000?
No, you can, because the way insurance is now structured, and the good thing is that it's also sold within banks, so you have very many outlets in which to actually get cover. Or insurance. So the way it's structured, you can either pay the premium, which is now you buying that protection. You can pay it annually, or you can pay it in slices on a monthly basis, depending on who your provider is. As I was giving you, the first example for me was health, and I see that benefit, because you walk in and you're not worried about getting treatment. And because the providers are all over the place, it works. I've also had incidents where motor vehicle, which is common that we see. I know many of us are forced to get the third party, but the comprehensive is also available, and it's quite useful where you get into a fix, you have an accident, maybe not necessarily your fault or could be yours for whatever reason. And to fix the car now, you have to fork out a huge chunk to kind of get you back to where you were before the incident. I think what insurance does for you is kind of set a base below which you don't fall, because you're risk participating. All of us within this room putting our money together in the event that one of us has a problem, instead of you having to pull from your pocket, the rest of us chip in.
Yes.
So that's really the way I would look at insurance. Now it goes further. You, as I said, you can look at health, you can look at the asset protection, but even now you can even mitigate against, yeah, there's education where you can mitigate against future events that could be adverse to you and your family. Mm-hmm. So in the event, God forbid, touch wood, anything happens to me, my children would still have the insurance company paying for them fees. Yeah, and that will ensure that they continue on that journey. Many of us think it's a luxury, but I don't think, because the one thing that's certain, as I've said, is change. Now, if you have cover at the back of it all, it doesn't hurt as much. If, as I said, God forbid, I'm not here, my children would still continue going to school. And many of us, the human being is a very interesting person. We want to aim for the largest bit, but we don't want to build it up. We just want to start with, can I get school fees for my university child? Now, how much would that cost? But you don't have to cover everything. I could say, fine, can I cover 20% of those fees? In the event anything happened to me, they don't have to look for that 20%. Yeah. And now there's a way in which if you go to a bank, and we do it as Tanchat here pretty well, we can structure for you an investment that actually pays for those premiums.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so you build a fixed income portfolio, you buy a couple of bonds, the income or the coupon of those bonds then pays for their insurance.
Really?
Yeah, so in essence, you're earning on your investment, but also getting protection. So those products are now available.
This particular part.
Yeah.
So I buy a bond of 100,000, like you earlier said in the earlier segment.
Yes.
And then I'm supposed to earn probably like after 6 months.
Let's just give a figure, 20,000.
Okay.
That you're earning off your bond.
Uh huh. So.
So I use the 20,000 to pay a premium.
Yeah.
To get me cover. So you have a child, and probably newly born, you don't know what the cost of education would be in 20 years when the kid is going into university. Near term, you probably feel you can still work, jobs are there, and you can manage within this space. But you don't know what will happen in 20 years. So you buy your bond, it's paying you 20,000 every 6 months. Go to your bank, ask if you can buy an education policy, yeah, that
In our case, EduCare.
EduCare for StanChart, where your premium is 20,000. Mm-hmm. So your bond pays you the 20,000, the bank pays the 20,000, bills that insurance product for you, probably covering whatever portion for your kid's education.
And you actually earn interest, don't you?
Yeah. So even from the policy itself, they do pay interest. It's much lower because of whatever that terms they are throwing in, if they're protecting you as well. So you can see how you're moving from investing,
yes,
and bundling that up with cover,
yes,
to protect yourself against those uncertainties that we can guarantee,
oh, wow,
will happen.
So to the Forex rate now, and the shilling opened the week on a weak footing against the dollar, trading at the levels of 3745, 3755, and slid marginally. And we hope that this doesn't drop further. Here's now the comprehensive report on the Forex and money market report. Alright, so the business quote for this week says, it's fine to celebrate success, but it's more important to heed the lessons of failure. I'll say that again. It's fine to celebrate success, but it's more important to heed the lessons of failure. When you feel you have made it, it's good to, you know, toast a bit and call the boys and have a blast. That's life. But don't forget the hard times that made you to succeed. The journey must always be there and must be remembered, because those are the lessons that make you. When people think it was all more like a walk in the park, you're going to tell them, look, it wasn't that. There are some things that we had to do to get here. So celebrate success, but it's important to heed to the lessons. And before I go, moments become memories and people become lessons. Moments become memories and people become lessons. That is just life. My name is Simon. I'll see you next week. You take care of yourselves from me and the team here. It's bye-bye.